thanks to your wife.
Yes, she's the first founder.
Right. Manju, Fabian, and their team managed a cleantech breakthrough against all odds. I stopped by their headquarters in Berlin and asked them how they did it. What are switchgears? Why do they typically use SF6? Why that is a problem? And how Nuventura fixed it? That's what we'll talk about today. I'm Kata, welcome to Net Zero Tech.
So this is a 36 kV switchgear, basically a switch like our room switch where we switch on a light or switch off. It just does the same job, just with higher voltage and higher current.
The use of SF6 in switchgears results in emissions equivalent to more than 100 million cars per year. What started with Manju and the support of his wife is now a 65-employee company and resulted in a catalytic event in the switchgear industry, causing the large players to take climate action. What got you all started and why did you decide to make it a business?
I come from electrical engineering background. And I was originally from India and I moved to Germany. I did my master's. At the time during the university days, I heard of this gas for the first time. Mm-hmm. And it was in the electrical industry. And I felt like this is something strong enough conviction for me to jump into.
Yeah.
Then I found some internships and I went to some companies, OEMs, who were doing this kind of product. I got a chance to do a lot of research and development activities. And it was a time for a young engineer to get as much knowledge as possible, learn everything what you can, and do everything what you can. This gave me an immense opportunity to get to know the products well, in and out, how to design these products, what do they do, what is that functionally it should be doing, and what is the role of SF6. And this sort of gave me an idea that there should be time where there was no SF6 and we should be still having power.
Yeah.
And how did we do it?
Yes.
And when I look back to 1970s or 1950s, this was the era there was no SF6. And we still had networks and power. And there were technologies which were doing the job.
Yes.
And this sort of gave me an idea that, okay, there is a path. So we, of course, we took a certain path. And then when we realized, okay, this is the gas which should not have been used, we can pivot. I spent quite some years in the research and development on this topic. At some point, I was thinking of going for some kind of PhD and going to academics. But then if you are only staying in academics, you don't bring this back to the product. Mm-hmm. However, in large organization, it's not so easy to bring a technology change.
Yeah.
There's a lot of decisions to be made. So it was too slow for my pace of activities. So I decided to leave a larger organization and take this as a personal journey. Mm-hmm. So like you said, it was a lucky shot to say. Either you do it or go home.
Yes.
So I wanted to give a try to make it happen. And then here we are.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Let's stay with the founder story a little bit. I've worked with several founders at different stages of the company, right? This is not what you see in the media usually, but it can be really aggravating, can be really tough. There can be moments. Yeah. I mean, if you ask a founder, I mean, if they're honest, usually they have, you know, a list of moments where they were close to giving up. Right. So what were some of those and how did you overcome them?
So I was never an entrepreneur before. I was an engineer. Mm-hmm. So my mind worked differently. And for the first time when I spoke to an entrepreneur, I asked, how is the journey? Mm-hmm. He told it's as if like you have glass bottle in your mouth. So it's going to be painful. I didn't understand what the person said at the time. So when I started as a one-person company, basically there was no company, it was only me or no one. And so everything happened in one brain. So it was a lot more easier because you have your own thoughts and then your own concerns and fears. Mm. However, funding such a big project was difficult with personal money.
Yeah.
So my wife was very generous to support me. To feed me well until I can prove something. And not only that, the network of people were also doing their best, just listening to the story, that what can they chip in. I went to some small switchgear companies, asked for shop floor support, that I want to build something, can I use your shop floor?
Mm-hmm.
People were very generous. Use what you want, use my people, do what you want to do, let's try.
Yeah.
So this kind of support was something I was not expecting, but this also gave me some kind of push. Okay, you know, it's possible to do from scratch.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very important to build something physical, that something exists and it operates.
Yes.
This was the bare minimum viable product you need to have
mm-hmm.
to even talk to someone, because these are not sexy products. They are not
yes.
an Apple phone or something. So nobody understands what is a switchgear.
Thanks to your wife.
Yes, she's the first founder.
Right. Yeah, I can't imagine. Yeah. When we look at the market, right, and for me, coming from the outside, viewing in, right, trying to understand the market is, like you said, it appears to be a very fragmented market. And you allow white labeling, which I found a really interesting concept, you know, especially for the commodity. At the end of the day, it's if you take the green premium away, it's a commodity. So you're
right.
competing on cost, right, with very little price elasticity. And then I think white labeling is really interesting. Can you elaborate on how the decision making, I mean, you're more probably still on the engineering side, but you're the founder, so
yeah.
you've kind of covered it all.
That's true.
Right?
Yeah.
So, because the IP, your patents, and the knowledge is so crucial, so important, right?
That's correct.
And so how do you share that
yeah.
and still stay in the market, right?
Yeah. I think it's a complex question, and also the answer is complex, so I try to detail it out a little bit, how the market is and why we decided to go in this path. So the market is predominantly, there are a few major players in the market who has the power to invest on the research and development and also stay in this market for a long period of time in the global market, being present in every country. And these kind of market players are also the decision makers on the products that can be in the market.
Okay.
And then there are tier two players who are not as big as the big ones, not a global player, but they can be the best company in the country level, supporting the local utility and so on. And then there are smaller players who are mostly doing servicing, doing last stage adjustments, and they buy from the big players, and then they are the local support for the local utility.
Mm-hmm.
This is how the market is segmented.
Yeah.
So the bigger organizations can develop blockbuster products.
Mm-hmm.
The tier two companies probably sometimes have products that they can develop on their own,
mm-hmm.
or most often depend on the big players. They are somehow part of the value chain. They buy from the big ones and then sell in the market, sort of get off licensing for the product,
mm-hmm.
for the region and so on. And the smaller ones usually stay with the older technologies, which
yeah.
are going away, and then they don't have access to the latest technology. When it comes to SF6 problem, this is a global problem. And this has been started, SF6 was used mostly in the most developed nations in 1970s. And then now it trickled down to all developing nations, underdeveloped nations in these years.
Mm-hmm.
It's very interesting to say now when Europe and US are all trying to get out of SF6, countries like China, Bangladesh, or African countries are getting into SF6.
Yeah.
So there is a transition. It takes time for everyone to get this technology. So by the time we are realizing to get out of it, and a large chunk of the population is ramping up this technology.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when we started the company, one of our values was beyond making money. It is very, very important for us to make sure that the technology is available for everyone. Otherwise, there is no point in only offering to markets where this product can be bought for the price, and then by the time we trickle it down to every country, the ecological damage is still happening.
Mm.
So we can't control that.
Yeah.
So we came up with the concept, why do we need to be another big OEM and need to have our own factories and then have our own sales and marketing organizations, and why should it be Nuventura selling it?
Yeah.
And we also realized in this kind of market, it's a very traditional market. So you need to be present in the market for 20, 30 years.
Mm.
Otherwise, your product will not go to critical infrastructure.
Yeah.
So nobody wants to buy a startup product
yes.
and then use it in a
yes.
In a major utility.
Yeah. Yes.
In critical infrastructures.
Yeah. I mean, the sheer size and the cost of it is one thing, but credibility is so important, especially when it comes to safety. And this is a, you know, like you say, critical or key component in the electrical grid. Okay, that makes sense.
So what we decided to do is to keep the core IP in the company. Mm-hmm. So this is the breakers and the switches we develop. And this is the core of the company and the technology to get rid of SF6.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something smaller players do not understand very well because they have not been developing products on their own.
Mm-hmm.
So we started to provide this kind of core technology to smaller companies and ask them to do what they regularly do. For example, relay automation and local services, installation, commissioning, maintenance, and so on. They are the local company who speaks the local language and who are nearby. When you call someone, they can come in 2 hours.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In this way, what they were good at, they get the value from that side. And we get our value where we are good at, and we mix these two combinations together. And when we looked into utility business or even into private markets, what is important is, one, you want to buy from the best manufacturer so that you have a certain credibility and so on. On the other side, you also need to have a good service, and you should be able to communicate.
Yes.
And there is also value for this, because once you buy an equipment, let's say it's not working, and you need someone to come there, it takes 6 months, it's also not going to work.
Yes.
So this is the reason why the local players are still existing. And what they need is the product that they can offer such that it can create a value.
Yeah.
And everybody wants to grow in the market, of course, and they need the next product to get into the market. And that is something which we can provide. So fundamentally what we do here is there is transformer, there are capacitors and cables, and we simulate a live situation that we bring in the voltage and then check all the switches whether they could operate in the worst case condition.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And this gives us a proof of the technology and also to the customer, okay, what they're buying is able to withstand the worst case scenarios, and then they can install it.
You said you're the only ones with a 36K, right?
Yeah.
Why?
So what was interesting was when we started developing the product, when I came out of a large organization and wanted to build a portfolio of product, it was easier for me to start from the lowest voltage and then go up in the ladder. But a lot of voices I heard in the market at that point of time was, it was still argued that it is impossible to get rid of SF6 in the product. It is so crucial and the technology is so prominent and there is no alternative. Technically, it's not possible, is what I heard.
Yeah.
And therefore, the regulatory bodies were confused. Okay, if the bigger company says technically it's not possible, then how would I regulate this? So every year, the company needs to buy these products. And therefore, as long as I don't see a product in the market, so I can't regulate it. They need to see a alternative technology coming up or working.
Yeah.
And for us, it is so important that when we invest capital resources and develop a product, we need to have a market to sell. And this market can only develop if there is a regulation binding it.
Yes.
So we wanted to understand what makes the regulations to tick.
Mm.
The critical problem is you don't have the highest voltage class. That's why the technology is not proven. So let's start with that. Mm-hmm. It's somewhat like the Tesla story. First, you make a roadster, and then once everything is working fine, you have proven the technology is okay, then you come to the commercial segment. So we had to take that approach, directly go to the highest voltage class and show this is possible and it's working. We put up a pilot project in 2018. We set up in a smaller grid area. We put our first prototype. And we made it run for 1 year. And then we wrote some technical papers and so on. This ignited some minds, and some of the regulatory bodies were interested to understand, is it really possible? Why are not the big one doing it and so on? Mm. I think the incentives are different for the big ones and for us. So for the companies who have a large portfolio and there are cash cows, so it is important to go iterative step, because there is also a lot of investment. I can understand this problem. If I would have been owning a bigger company, I would think in the same way. Okay, I can start with a smaller portion of the market, change it slowly, and take my time, and let the market get ready.
Mm-hmm.
But for us, it is a different story. We had to churn up the market to get ready.
Yes.
Because no one was doing it.
Yeah.
This is the same problem I found in the last 15 years. Once I started understanding these products, there is no catalytic event in the market.
Yeah.
Everyone is playing safe. And no one wants to jump in to expose a newer technology and then do it, go ahead in the market.
Yeah.
Because there is no push for this product unless there is a regulation.
Yeah.
So the regulatory body, manufacturers, utilities are like three corners.
Mm-hmm.
And none of them go ahead and say, this is what's going to happen.
Okay.
So we needed someone to create a catalytic event. And that was Nuventura at the time.
Okay.
And therefore, we had a 36 kV.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Before you said Tesla, I was exactly thinking of that.
Yeah.
Because at the time, with Alba Paul, I did cleantech open accelerator, right? And there was one of the early and long-term Tesla employees, and they were talking about that specifically, that they had to work with the regulator, that they had to essentially write the laws for these things. It's kind of fascinating. And then exactly the same story with Tesla as well. You start with the luxury product because they can sell it at a premium. And then you work your way down the cost curve.
Yeah. Correct, yes.
Okay.
And I think at some point of time, we will have other market players realizing this, trying to do what we have done, which is also good because we cannot sell being alone in the market. We need to have partners who also can offer the same technology.
Thank you very much for watching. Special thanks to my Patreon members. Let me know if you have any questions below and see you in the next one. Bye.